have come to visit you in peace and with goodwill.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to Earth vs. Soup, episode 47. I'm Aaron Pollyea.
I'm Darlene.
And we're talking about...
Gog
today.
It's the third of a series of Office of Scientific Investigation, OSI.
We did a review
we
for
did
the
a
second
review
movie.
For the second one, Riders of the Stars, 1957. That was our number four.
57. This is 54.
So 54. This is... Yeah. No, it was 54.
Oh, okay.
And the other one was Magnetic Monster, 1953, which we can't find.
Yeah, we can't find a copy of that. And I do want to watch that if we ever do get a copy of it, because... yeah, I need to see them all. Because
they're all written by...
yeah, they're written by the same guy.
I didn't
write it down. Now we're having to remember Tom Taggart and Richard G. Taylor. Ivan Tors.
They're all done by Ivan Tors. Thank you for that name.
Okay, so...
I was looking for it on my sheet of paper.
Riders to the Stars. What episode was that again? That we
Riders to the Stars is episode 4.
Oh, so way back in the beginning.
Way back, because I wanted to do the Magnetic Monsters.
Yeah.
And we
yeah.
couldn't find it, and then we ended up just doing...
Different
Riders to the Stars.
Yeah.
Instead, because that's the only one
so
we could find.
So we both liked Riders to the Stars, even though the...
I don't know, did I?
I'm pretty sure I recommended that film because it was so bonkers. There were parts of it that were really, really bonkers. Darlene's going back through her notes now. Because we take notes on all these films, folks. I doubt that you would have written down if you would recommend it or not. Because usually you say off the cuff. I'm pretty sure I did.
It had its own song. Moon is Turning into Dust by Cosmic Rays.
I mean...
Stock footage.
Lots of
the
stock V2, footage.
Which this one has too.
Yeah.
There was some problems with science like this one does. The romance was embarrassing.
Yes, but I'm pretty sure I recommended it because we got to see the Jeep going through the desert with crazy drivers.
Is that the one with
Oh yeah, darling. Come on. That's the one with the where people could have died on set because they were just driving like madmen. That was also the thing that like cosmic rays were making rockets brittle. So they had to figure out what allowed meteors to stay in one piece out in space for so long. And it turns out as long as they're covered in diamond, like, so we have to cover all of our rockets in diamond. That's the solution. Okay. So, I guess they come up with the solution
because this is another.
Well, yeah, this is the last film.
Because they're going to send up a shuttle.
A station.
A station.
Okay, so this is the third in the OSI, and supposedly there's scientific advisors from the University of Southern California that are there. There was for the second film, Riders to the Stars, and there's only so far I can actually give the writers and the makers of this movie leeway on the scientific inaccuracies that are in this movie because they had scientific advisors, and some of it is just baffling. Why it's so bad. And then there's stuff in here that is really forward thinking. Like stuff that we would be talking about in modern times.
Yeah, but
we'll get to that. I'm covering the plot.
It was the budget was $250,000 at the time, which you said was about
$2.5 million today in 2021, and
it's in color, people.
So to me, if I said $2.5 million and this movie was made today, I would say, yeah, that's actually it looks like a I think it looks better than a $2.5 million movie, in my opinion. because I mean, I generally will say Asylum films on like Sci-Fi Channel, $1 million, and you generally have really high paid actors in it. Sorry. And you have high paid actors in it, so a lot of the money ends up going to the talent, and it kind of shows. Even though you might have good location shots, the stuff that's to the side, you know, props, sets, things like that, suffer in those movies. Where this, it's like, okay, you don't have high budget actors, but the sets all look good. The props generally really look good.
They use a lot of, in this, in what we see a lot is TV actors with a few movies. So they've got the experience, because you go through all these people's listing of where they were and what they are, and they've got a lot of acting skills and stuff like that, but they're not
well, I wouldn't say they're well known or high profile. You know, we're not talking about like Clark Gable or anything like that. You know, we're not talking, there's no Errol Flynn in these movies, right? Okay. Anyway, let's talk about the plot, because it's OSI. And this movie starts off with a really cool credit sequence that has paintings of like rocket launches. And I thought, wow, that's pretty good. That looks really good. Supposedly there's actual scientific advisors in this movie, which are listed at the beginning. And then we go to a test lab where there's a monkey hooked up to a whole bunch of sensors.
Oh, she's hooking them up to
and they inject them and make them go to sleep. They then reduce the temperature in this lab to like at first 10 below zero Fahrenheit, then to 40 below Fahrenheit, then to 85. The monkey freezes solid.
At 85.
Yeah, zero heartbeat, pulse, or respiration. They warm him up and he's fine. And I guess it's because of this injection that they had given him. The doctor ends up going into this test chamber and gets locked in.
And this is what I would say would be worthy of even today's science thought, is the chronic.
Well, they're doing cryogenics.
Testing. Yeah. And we haven't perfected cryogenics.
Well, there's other things in this. Remember, there's lots of stuff that happens with Novak in this that is actually kind of.
Yeah, something really, that can happen today.
Yeah, stuff that can happen today. The doctor ends up getting shut in the test lab room. And it's weird because the door kind of shuts itself and then locks itself.
And these spinning hand.
You know, like you think you see on bank vaults, like these big.
Yes. But they've also got those as their control things, too, for the temperature and that.
Yeah.
And they move.
Yeah. So the test equipment seems to start running itself, and he freezes solid and falls back. He's screaming for help, but then just freezes solid. His female lab assistant comes in and is locked in as well, also freezes solid.
Well,
and
she
dies.
Screams.
Yeah,
and the door just shuts on her.
So it looked, you know, if you were just watching this completely without understanding that this was a scientifically advised film, you'd assume that there were ghosts. Like, there's no reason why this should happen. This is 1954. But if this was a modern film, you would immediately think what it really is. At least to me, it's pretty clear what it is, what's going on. Now, we find out later on that this doctor and this lab assistant were not just frozen solid and died. They froze solid and shattered, yes. All T-1000 style. They don't show that, thankfully, because, I mean, obviously, this is 1954. We're not going to show that. But, I mean, everyone at this lab is horrified by it.
Then you go to
what we do is we go to an outside shot. It's out in the desert, and we see an MC-4C tandem rotor helicopter.
I thought there was a scene where it was the person sending this guy to the base. That was supposed to be in D.C. or something.
Doesn't matter. There's a guy that's coming to the base to investigate. The helicopter takes control of its flight as it gets close to this base. This investigator guy, his name is what? Dr. Shepard?
Yes, it's David Shepard.
David Shepard, played by Richard Egan. Richard Egan, I guess, was in a lot of things. He was in a lot of TV shows, like we were saying. He was in a few movies. But anyway, what we see, he's kind of shocked, and it's explained that the base's computer takes control of any aircraft coming into the base to keep its location secret. I'm like, okay. So no one knows exactly where the base is, but you're in an open cockpit helicopter. You can literally just look and see where you're going.
And at the time, they also have up at this mirror that comes up.
Yes, and starts flashing at them or something like that. And it, I guess it's like a, well, what it is it's a solar reflector. And it can focus light on a target and basically burn it out like a death ray. And that is not insane. That is actually a pretty reasonable type thing.
Well, look at how many times we took as a kid, we used to take magnifying glasses and burn grass.
Yeah. So Dr. Shepard arrives and meets with the guy that's in charge. His name is Dr. Van Ness.
Yep.
And Shepard worked for the OSS during World War II, which is the predecessor to like the CIA and all that. So he has like intelligence work behind him because there's been weird things happening around the base and everyone thinks that there's like a saboteur.
But his assistant is in the room, isn't he? The girl that you say has got the square face.
Yes, I forget. Is she the actress is Constance Dowling, and so she plays Joanna.
It was never said who her name was.
I think it was said one time.
But she's supposed to be some love interest from before.
I think it was from during the war that they knew each other during the war, and they had some sort of OSS background together. Anyway, Van Ness says that they're going to conquer space by freezing pilots and have robots at the controls and then thaw out all of the pilots once they get to their destination with radar beams. And I'm like, okay, all right, well, they're talking about microwave ovening their pilots to warm them up because radar beams melted chocolate in people's pockets back during World War II, and that's what microwave ovens are. That's what they're kind of talking about. Now, if there's some sort of antifreeze injection like they gave the monkey, okay, I can see a cryogenics thing. But tossing people into a glorified microwave oven to warm them up once they get there, that just seems weird to me. But he's ordered to find whoever the saboteurs are and to stop them. Now,
but we also use microwaves today.
To warm
our food.
Yeah, because it warms from the inside out, and then you can burn things in the inside before the outside's unfrozen. Anyway.
Yeah, you should know that because you defrost
anything in there. All right, so what happens basically in the large second act of this movie is scene after scene of exposition. And this is somewhat similar to Riders to the Stars, where it's clear that their scientific advisors gave them lots of ideas, the writers lots of ideas, and they wanted to put a lot of these ideas up in front of the movie-going audience. So, yeah, they actually call her Miss Merritt, because I have written down Miss Merritt. She talks about how two radar beacons were found on the base. And they're the kind of things that could be used to guide in radar-controlled rockets or aircraft armed with atomic weapons. And so they go into this whole explanation of how this underground base could survive a nuclear attack, but it's not really designed to survive a direct attack with a hydrogen bomb. I don't know. It's another thing of exposition. A third transmitter is found during this discussion, so everyone's like, wow, there's some... there's some problems going on. There is a scene where they show off the space station design, which is a ring station. And it is said that it will utilize focused sunlight to thermally generate steam to power a turbine. And I'm like, okay, hold on.
The station has a small, it looks like a radar dish.
Yeah, and it's there to focus light. And see, okay, so I have to go into the whole, remember that space is like a thermos. Vacuum insulates. So when you dump heat into a space station to generate power like that, which would work, you're going to heat the whole spacecraft up and have a very difficult time cooling it back down. That's the, believe it or not, one of the bigger problems in space is thermally regulating your spacecraft. You have to have radiators, heat vanes, things like that. So if you're sitting there having to constantly power the spaceship with a steam turbine, unless you're dumping your steam out of the ship, you're kind of insulating all of that constant heat inside your spacecraft, and you're going to kill your crew. And they don't really ever explain. There's nothing on the spacecraft model, the space station model, that suggests any kind of radiators, heat sinks, heat vanes, and even heat sinks after a while would be tapped
out.
This
is 1954.
And they should understand that thermoses insulate whatever is inside of them, and their, you know, vacuum therefore will insulate the space station. Anyway, this is why I say, like, they have scientific advisors on there. And it seems really...
Well, the scientific advisors probably weren't at, didn't watch this movie at the end of it and go,
so
what?
Then we go into a demonstration of the solar focusing device and kind of a cool set. And they show, like, hey, if here's how we can use this to melt metals. Because if we focus sunlight through these, like, curved mirrors, we can beam all this energy into like a bar of iron or whatever, and it melts in this crucible.
Let me just put it this way. Aaron was boring me by shutting off the thing and looking up stuff.
Yeah, I was having to like...
And what's the funny part about this one is I found it
before I was able to, because I was trying to look for thermal... the amount of thermal energy an element can actually hold with a given amount of mass. And it's different. Like a gram of water can hold less heat than, like, let's say a gram of iron. So one of the lines that gets said is that if we heat even a speck of iron to the temperature of the sun, it would radiate enough heat to blast all life in a radius of 1,000 miles. And I'm like, okay, that's a bold statement, movie. You have scientific advisors on here, and that sounds BS to me. So I had to pause it, and this is where Darlene's like, oh my God, I can't believe you're going to... I'm like, no, no, I can't let this stand. If they're
right... Then he runs to the computer.
And I'm going through, like, and Darlene helps me find it. And it turns out that if we said a speck is 1 gram of iron, which I think is a fair enough thing, and we heat it to, let's say, 40 million degrees Celsius, which is really hot. Like, the center of the sun isn't that hot, but this is, like, hot. It would be about 4 million calories inside this 1 gram of iron. And that means it actually comes out to having the thermal energy of 8 pounds of TNT. So a far, far cry.
A claymore has more.
Yeah, with all the C4 in it. Yeah, like, it's not going to blast all life within 1,000 miles if you're heating a speck of iron to the center of the sun's temperature. Let's put it that way. And I'm sorry for, like, going off on that, but, like, when movies have scientific advisors and tout the fact that they have scientific advisors at the beginning of the movie, and they make a statement like that, I have to check it. They start talking about how mirrors in space could be used as a weapon. The computer is the thing that takes care of this auto-focusing device that they have. And then they start going into another exposition scene about how the people on this hypothetical space station, they built it as a ring station, okay? Yes. But they're not going to rotate it for some reason because they're not going to have gravity on board. So they said instead they're going to generate a magnetic field and build magnetic boots and clothes that provide the effects of gravity. And I'm putting in quotes here. And they demonstrate this by, like, two people that are, like, dancers wearing chainmail bikinis and, like, tank tops. and they turn magnets on so they start flying around. It's really ridiculous. It's really ridiculous.
Hey, kudos to those two people because they had to have been dancers.
And they were wearing chainmail and like...
And aluminum, okay?
Well, that's what they say. It's like an aluminum alloy that's going to be this magnetic.
And my whole laugh of that one was, aluminum is not magnetic.
Well, okay. Anything is magnetic under a large enough magnetic field. Let's be honest. There is like, yeah, in any reasonable circumstance, aluminum is not going to be magnetic. But, okay, anyway.
I understand that one is that you don't, we can't magnetize aluminum.
We then go to the monitoring room where there's the instrument panel full of tuning forks.
Oh, that's their
yeah, it's their like early warning system. It detects if there's like airplanes moving nearby. And the thing is that it's so sensitive that it amplifies any sound that it detects in a certain range. So you can tell if there's an airplane going by. And in fact, there is, and it shows that there's a plane traveling supersonic in the area, but they can't detect it with their radar. They don't understand what's going on.
Because it's supposed to be some fiberglass or something.
We learn that later on. And then we go down and see Novak, which is a badass old school computer. And they had full on plug-in vacuum tube units that I absolutely love. Everything was like ticker tape and punch cards.
The doctor, is that Dr. Yetzman?
I think so.
He was a dick. He was one that really needed to be fired.
Or was it like Dr. Elsevier or something like that?
No, Elsevier also had a... Madame Elsevier is the gray-haired woman.
Oh, yeah, that's right. So the Elseviers are the people with the sunlight thing.
Yeah.
Okay, so anyway, we find out that NOVAC, the computer, is an abbreviation for Nuclear Operative Variable Automatic Computer, and it basically maintains the nuclear pile that powers this base. And we see Gog and Magog, which Gog is what the movie is named after, and they are effectively proto-Daleks. Like,
they,
this is 1954.
Robots.
This is way before Doctor Who, but there's
claw arms,
yes.
And what we find out is a flamethrower.
Well, it's supposed to be like a welding torch or something, but it can be used as a flamethrower. They have many resemblances to what Daleks will be later on, like 10 years later. They have like a round head. They have like this kind of weird Art Deco grilling where the person inside the robot can actually look out. They have lights on their heads.
They even have that weird...
There's like an eye that kind of pokes out from the center of their head a little oddly. They have tank treads for wheels, though, or, you know, instead of like just the Dalek skirt. But I'm saying...
And they have a radar.
The Daleks are different enough that there could be no lawsuit from these people.
No.
Because the Daleks are very unique and very distinct. But
those robots are neat.
Those robots are really cool looking. And they reminded me somewhat of Daleks.
But they used ticker tape.
Yeah.
And this is the one that got me, because the guy just threw it in the trash can.
And you freaked out immediately. You're like, that's security. And then,
the guy says it's a security problem. And this guy just flips.
Yeah, big deal. Whatever. I'll run this lab the way I want to run it. And this guy's like, bitch, please. I am OSS. I will cap you tonight if you don't start actually operating this lab.
And the guy still took it and threw it in the trash can.
Yeah.
So somebody could have taken these things that are coded for the robots, ran them, and took control of it. Because this guy was irresponsible.
Yeah, basically all of the problems come down to this douchebag not following operational procedure, like security procedures. It's all the problems in the movie, all the deaths come down to that one guy just not caring. The computer scientist, yes, is a complete dick.
And he's not even nice to the person that works with him.
No, he's not. So we go through some more exposition. Like I said, Act 2, which is maybe two-thirds of this movie, is all exposition. It's just, here is scientific curiosities or interesting
ideas. Here's room
ideas.
One. Here's room two. Here's room
now,
three.
We say that and you're like, oh God, that sounds so boring. It actually isn't, because when they're going through this, there's really cool things that they're trying to show you.
As long as your person doesn't stop the doggone...
And try to fact check them. I'm sorry.
Fact check
it. What I'm saying is, if we watch this like Unbroken...
Unbroken, I probably would have enjoyed it a lot better than I just did.
Yeah, I know. It's actually not annoying exposition. So they end up finding, like, they go down to the nuclear pile, and they get to see all the Waldos in the nuclear pile operating.
Yeah, that just didn't sound... There was these little lenses that they were looking through.
That is what you have. You even have that on nuclear-powered aircraft carriers. You have these little lenses that you look through, because you cannot look into the core area. Like, you have to look through filters, and you don't want to be exposed to the radiation, so you have all this shielding, and then you use your Waldos, which are basically robotic hands that are controlled by whatever, joysticks.
So they took stock footage.
I can almost guarantee that was stock footage, but when you think about it, that's really obscure stock footage that not a lot of people...
Even the red lensed one?
Yeah, because you're wanting to filter out all the high energy stuff that's coming out of there. So yeah, everything's going to be red tinged.
And that was the last
exposition
stuff.
But we find out that there's high concentration of alpha radiation on level 2.
Yeah, there's levels. Level one's
like administrative. Level two is a lot of the like basic labs, let's say.
Level 3 is the computer. Level 4 is the nuclear
pile and like bomb shelter, effectively. All right, so they go up there and they're screaming about how there's like 300 millirenken in here.
In the second floor.
Yeah, in like
level two.
Is it the biology lab?
I think it was.
And I was like, well, that's nothing. That's like 0.26 rads. It's not really enough to kill anybody. But like, I guess the woman just keels over and is highly radioactive.
It came in a plant,
and they put, and this was smart, they put like a glass dome over the plant. And I'm like, and you said, that doesn't make sense. That's not going to say. And I'm like, well, hold on. If it's only giving off alpha radiation, that will completely protect everybody, because alpha radiation is typically stopped by a couple sheets of paper at the most of density. So if you have like a thick glass bowl and you put it over an alpha source, you're not going to get it. My Geiger counter that I have upstairs, Darlene, is not rated to detect alpha radiation because it's covered in a little tiny, like 2 millimeters of plastic. And that's more than enough to stop alpha radiation. Now, with that being said, alpha radiation can still hurt you, even though you think, well, my skin is going to stop it. It's not going to hit my bones. The thing is, it can cause tissue damage because it will still get in underneath your upper dead layer of skin.
Yes, but she wasn't, from what I understand of any radiation, you would have blistering and stuff like
yes.
that. Just like have.
She was fine.
You'd first look like you had sunburn.
Yeah. Yeah.
And as it went deeper, it would go, unless you were somebody like that one guy that was in England that was fed.
Oh, that poor guy. Let's not talk about that. I don't want to talk about that and make people upset. Anyway, we see the centrifuge room with two test pilots being used, a male and a female. And by the way, they talk about in this movie how women are really good for the space program. And that's actually true. And I'm like, hey, that's good that they bring this up, because women, and they go through like the, it sounds bad, but
it's
actually
they're
is
smaller
true.
Is what they said.
Yeah, well, they said they're smaller, so they take up less room and less resources to man a spacecraft. And I'm like, well, okay, that's, if you're talking about the average woman being smaller than the average man, yes, that's true. That women are typically better insulated against extreme temperatures because women have
fat distribution all over them where men do not.
Yes, where men do not. And once again, that seems like, oh, that's an awful thing to say. Actually, it isn't. It's fair enough, right? And the fact that women can take more acceleration.
Well, that's because of the fat distribution again.
Yes. So in many ways, women are better suited on average than men. Now, that's not saying that there's some men that are actually far better suited or some women that are far better suited. But anyway, the centrifuge has a man and a woman in it, and it spins up to like 60 Gs and kills them.
Yeah, and the bad part about that one is you notice
it killed dummies.
Really dummies. They actually, when it stops spinning, okay, they crash over to them running into with the door.
Yeah.
And that's when you have the person, you know, that's when the person got into
they got back in the chair.
They got the person, because all the time, the first scene, that was a dummy in the females.
Talk about the solar mirror killing somebody.
You do this to me, and I never get to. He walked out of the room on me.
Sorry, I'm back. No, I'm back. It's okay. We have a life going on in the background. The next scene goes to the mirror room, and suddenly the solar mirror tries to kill a woman.
That was trying to kill Madame
Elsevier.
Elsevier with her gray wig to make her look old.
Okay. So
that doesn't work.
Then we go to the detector room again, and all of the tuning forks are going crazy. Now,
but you forgot that they found four more of those little
radar,
those little boxes,
radio boxes. It turns out that this detection device can generate sound up. Well, the gauge shows up to 500 decibels. Okay. So they have designed a detector grid that amplifies sound that can kill the operator. Like, this baffles me. And in fact, it does in this next scene, because
the security guy gets the people out.
Yeah.
And then he tries to shut it down.
Yes.
I think he does, but he ends up dead.
Yeah, he ends up dead because he's exposed to at least 200 decibels right next to him, which is like being next to a bomb detonating. It's that kind of pressure wave on you. Like Krakatoa exploding was a quieter sound than 200 decibels. There's like upper limits to how loud a noise can be. And that's getting very close to something cannot be any louder than that. And yet their gauge goes up to 500.
Yes.
So this guy... this guy is killed, and I don't understand why they would have built a detection grid that can literally kill everyone around them, around it, operating it.
Because they didn't have the science people come in afterwards and go,
dumb. This is really dumb. I cannot believe you're doing this. Okay, so it turns out, well, they figure out that Novak is being controlled from an outside source.
With an airplane.
There's an airplane circling like really, really high
because
up.
He puts one of those boxes onto that thing before it gets, what's his name, David Shepard.
Yeah. So this aircraft is up at super high altitudes transmitting a radio beam down to the base that is interfering with Novak's control systems. And effectively, the enemy... and whoever that is, because they don't mention who the enemy is, you can assume it's the Soviets, have basically hacked the base's computer and taken control of it.
And
they're doing so via an aircraft that is a stealth aircraft made from composite materials. And this is where I said, sometimes this movie is kind of shocking at how modern it seems.
Yeah. And the two people, the woman Joanna and Shepard, run down to the the computer lab
to try to shut the computer down, because the computer is going to overload the nuclear pile. Yeah.
And the lab, his assistant gets killed.
Well, doesn't the doctor get killed down there?
Well,
too?
He gets it because he's holding off. One of them is gone.
Yeah.
Magog.
That's
Magog
gone.
Is gone into the nuclear or whatever.
Yeah, and it's screwing with the reactor control rods or something.
And Gog starts fighting
Shepard. But
he's holding off it by a stick. And he trips.
And he dies.
And he gets killed that
way.
Okay,
but we found out earlier in the film that these robots sense where people are via infrared heat energy. Okay, that makes sense. And I'm like, well, that's going to be Chekhov's infrared detector. That has to come up later on. And it does, because they said the only way we can kill these things, these robots, is since they are armored to operate inside a nuclear, you know, hostile environment, guns aren't going to kill them. We have to use flamethrowers to, like, melt their systems. And
but wouldn't a nuclear reactor...
Not necessarily. Not necessarily. And not necessarily. Not if it's operating properly.
Well, they're definitely making it so it doesn't operate
well,
properly.
Well, I mean, Magog is probably going to sacrifice itself. Anyway, they get a flamethrower, and it's a pretty cool flamethrower. Shepard gets a flamethrower and starts cooking. Is it Gog that's
it's
out
Gog.
There? Yeah. And he gets it almost killed. And then, he does kill it because Magog comes in afterwards and he's like, okay, I got to cook this thing too. And his flamethrower runs out of fuel because he's just basically blasted 30 seconds worth of flamethrower on this thing. And that's where we see Dr. Van Ness come in with a second flamethrower and screw up Magog. And we have to, now that the robots are done, we need to signal the Air Force base nearby to go take out this orbiting plane, right?
Yeah, there's where we get a laugh of stock footage.
Okay, so yeah, it's stock footage. Some of it's stock footage and some of it isn't, which is really interesting.
What isn't is the
F-86s.
F-86s.
That's not stock
because
footage.
Because they were filming it on that base, George...
Yeah, it's George Air Force Base.
George Air Force Base.
So that's not... That was actually filmed for this movie, not stock footage.
And the next... The ones that actually blast whatever.
They're starfighters.
They're starfighters. Those were on George the base.
Yes,
George
they
too,
were.
But that was stock footage.
And neither of those aircraft have an operational ceiling that's anywhere close to the altitude that the enemy aircraft was operating at. But they probably didn't have to get up there anyway. They just needed to get up high enough to get missile lock. And the missiles probably could have just gone up there.
But
no
if
problem
it,
anyway.
If they couldn't spot it with... How could they lock it?
I think they probably eyeballed it, and then it was not infrared. Like, its infrared signature is
your
what they
worst
were able
enemy,
to lock.
The deadliest person in the galaxy, is whom?
Newton. But Newton has nothing to do with this.
You don't eyeball it.
Well, you don't need to. I'm saying is it might be radar transparent, but it wasn't infrared transparent, and the missiles could have had infrared sensors on them to guide them in. They could have.
Anyway,
we get to see some numbers on some F-86s, and we find out one of the F-86s that...
The main one that you see, the guy with his...
It crashed right after the making of this movie and killed the pilot, which is really sad. That could have been the actual pilot that we saw. We don't know.
Probably, since their names are usually on their planes.
That plane... crashed right after this movie, and that's kind of that
if
is
that's
sad.
The actual person that
it's F-86 F-25NH code number 51-13384. Yeah, I can look up all this information because there are actual F-86s still flying in private hands today. We see them at Oshkosh every now and then. It's you don't get many planes old, newer than that because they're too expensive to fly, and generally owning, like, let's say a F-4 Phantom or an F-16 is a little too costly to operate for anyone. So the F-86 is about the limits of fuel cost that most people can handle. That's the end of the movie. They take out this rocket, and I guess everything goes okay. And then they say they're going to launch this model station into orbit as a proof of concept. And they show a V2 rocket launching.
A V2. And I didn't think it was the model. I thought it was the...
No, they were going to actually send that small model station because it was an operational model into orbit.
Oh, some more stuff for the Cascade.
The Kessler Cascade, yeah. For the future Kessler Cascade. So that's the end of the movie. Let's talk about it. I know I've already said that there's things that do and don't work in this movie.
Do work is the credits. I really like the pictures, the drawings that they did for the credits.
Yeah.
I liked the base. It looked like, well, it was showing the base. It was actually showing the base. I actually think the hallway, there was a hallways that they were going down. I think that was actually on the base too, because it looked like Air Force standard.
I'll tell you what.
Hallways.
Yeah, I agree. I think the Magog, not the Magog. Well, the robots are fantastic.
The robots are fantastic.
Novak, the computer, that is a piece of art. And it might not seem like that to people that don't appreciate the old computers.
You had to pull out these things.
Like big, yeah. I mean, I have parts of an old, the original. I have parts to old computers. And they're like plugging, they're like big cards that have vacuum tubes on them, and I don't know, it's art to me. It's art. Like, there's so many little intricate pieces to these things that it's amazing that they worked. I don't know, it's hard to describe. I love that computer. I think it was a really cool prop, even though it was just like a cabinet on the wall. Obviously somebody cared enough to put the detail in the fact that you can pop out these,
because the assistant pulls out one.
So maybe is that an actual operational computer? I don't know. It could have been an operational computer.
It could have been one that was in
and on the base, but they wouldn't have allowed that to be filmed.
No,
that had to be at UCLA or something like that. That'd be a UCLA computer system.
At this time it would have been, because that one was kind of like the 1940s.
No. That was early 50s.
That was early 50s,
yeah. Okay. So that worked. What else worked to you?
Not some of the acting, but some of it was shoddy at other times.
So what didn't work?
What didn't here work? The gray hair.
Okay, so some of the makeup was really weird.
No, this lady was probably in her 20s, and they were trying to make her look like she was...
Okay.
So
the makeup...
Dr. Phaser's wife, I guess.
The makeup doesn't work in some of it. I would say that some of the costuming doesn't work. Some of it does, but...
Those suits that they had
like
to wear?
Like, the weird jumpsuit is very strange for some of the women's jumpsuits. Yeah. I don't think that works.
The two dancers, weird stuff. Yes, that didn't work.
The chainmail was just... It's so bizarre. I don't know.
They were in their dance leotards,
and then have the,
and then
they
had the chainmail over top of it, and yeah, that did look weird.
It looked weird, but did that not? I don't know if I would say that didn't work, because it's just so weird. Like, okay, I can't say it worked because, well, I can't say it worked, but I can't
say it didn't.
The
tuning forks.
The science about half the science in this film was insane and just completely, this is wrong, or this would never have been built for OSHA compliance. Like, this is an OSHA hazard. This can literally kill its operator. Not that OSHA was there, but you know what I mean? Like, no one would ever use something that can kill you just from something being around. Like, you don't make...
Well, if you did, you'd put it in its own room.
And you wouldn't have somebody standing next to it.
You would, the first one with the monkey, it should have had a shutdown button
on the inside. Well, yeah, so no one would actually be killed. No, it's the tuning forks is just, it's, why wouldn't you build that with some sort of safety so it wouldn't get too loud?
or put it in its own room with a box.
I just don't understand it. Why is it designed to literally kill its operators?
Because something like that would be pulling it off, and then it would be doing like the seismograph would.
Yeah, exactly. You would have it like, it would display a graph or something like that. And you wouldn't ever have these tuning forks just sitting there producing up to 500 decibels of sound in your room. Like, I just don't understand that. And then about half the science, the other half of the science is actually like, wow, that's really good.
See, I could see the mirror one. You wanting to see how hot your things could get. But again, you would be doing like a radar, you know, you go to for an X-ray.
Yeah.
You're stuck there with this whatever.
Yeah.
And they're in another room.
Yes.
And that's how you would do.
You would not be in the same room as the deadly beam of light that can literally cut you in half. Yes. We remember the disaster of the one Russian technician who walked in front of the particle accelerator beam and killed himself. Like, you just don't do these things. It baffles me. Like, there's parts of this movie just baffle me. And then there's, like, parts that are really inspired. So what can you take away from this movie?
Let's see. OSHA standards?
Like, yeah,
let's think about movies and think about how they'd have to have the safety.
Yeah, no, it's
of your people.
It's,
you certainly want.
It's the Plinkett first contact review with the poor security guy sitting behind Picard, with Picard telling everybody his plan to like burst the flesh melting gas out of the warp core, and the guy behind him just going, oh my god, what am I?
You could tell this was a Star Trek probably fan that got to be in the movie.
Because
and he's
like,
yeah, I've got this thing.
This
and then
like,
he's like,
screw this. There's no way I'm going in there. And then like Plinkett's like, send McGillicuddy. You know, I don't want to do it. I'll stay out in the corridor. Like, who would do that? Who would build something that can literally just kill you at the slightest whim and put no safety precautions around it? Like, I don't know. If you're making a movie, if your actors would say, I think this might be dangerous, I don't think my character is this dumb, listen to them. Or like, if your scientific advisor goes, I don't know.
Well, I think their scientific advisors were there before the movie got started.
And then they added
stuff later. I'm going to put that as, because any person that understood science at all, because
there's really good science in this with like the alpha particles and the glass,
but there's like some very big dumb ones like the aluminum,
magnetic aluminum. Yeah,
I am not science swabby.
Well, it's also, even if you had magnetic aluminum, even if the point is that you're not going to just turn magnets on and create gravity for people wearing chainmail bikinis. Like, that's just not how it works. And you're literally wanting to build a ring station, so why don't you just put a spin on it so you can have spin gravity instead of having to use a whole ton of power to produce a magnetic field so people in chainmail bikinis can can like be dragged to the floor. I don't get it. Do I recommend this movie though? Yes.
No.
Yes,
yeah.
I do.
And I gotta watch it again to really recommend it, because Aaron kept on snagging me
and going, no, we have to check this. This is
and I'm like,
bad. Yeah.
This movie was like 3 hours long to me, because somebody started.
It is actually kind of long. What is it like 120 minutes or something? I mean, not 120 minutes. Hour and 23 minutes.
Yeah.
Hour and 20. Yeah, hour 23. Okay. So
it's kind of long, but
for a 1950s movie.
Yeah.
It's not long for a movie, but it's long for like a 1950s B movie.
Okay, today a long movie is 3 hours.
Yeah, yeah.
And they stick it full of crappy doggone action that you're like, why is this person doing this?
At the very least, the fluff in this movie wasn't action. It was people talking about scientific ideas. And I can appreciate that. I can appreciate that.
And some of them are still, like the cryogenics is still something we're...
They could have done a whole movie just centered on the cryogenic thing.
Which is what I thought the movie was going to be about because of those two people. It was...
Like, yeah, it could have been completely...
That's a golden monkey, too, by the way.
It could have been an entire movie where humans are in the spaceship and Gog and Magog are on the spaceship and the humans are frozen and they need to, like, fight the robots but also make a choice between, like, who needs to continue the fight. We don't have enough air to have everybody, you know, on the spaceship awake. We need to see if we can put other people back into cryo, and the robots are the ones that normally do it, so we have to figure out how to do it ourselves, etc., etc., etc. Like, you could have had a whole movie like that. There's a lot of things. Like, we have to... there's a whole movie where you could deal with that solar mirror and, like, the death ray from the solar mirror. There's a whole movie dealing
with... Well, this whole movie was really about Novak.
Yeah, the computer.
Being...
Hacked.
Because some dumb doggone scientist that created the
didn't care about security. Yeah.
That is the whole movie right there.
Yeah.
So he needed to be fired right off the bat.
I will say that Riders to the Stars, the second movie, is
and thrown better, in and thrown in Leavenworth.
The second movie is better than this one, I will say. But I think this has more interesting ideas in it. So I don't know. It's a recommendation from both of us.
Sort of by me.
Yeah. It's a weak recommendation for me because it is entertaining. There's a lot of really cool things in it, but is it a good movie? Not really. Like there aren't a ton of movies that I would say are firmly good that we've watched out of the 47. Like, yeah, there are Time Machine, War of the Worlds.
We've got two movies to go,
and then we'll do our 50 movie breakdown. Yeah, our 50 movie anniversary. So yeah, we'll talk about that a little more. But yeah, it's a recommendation from both of us. So that's Gog from 1954. I'm Aaron.
I'm Darlene.
Thanks for listening.
Good night.
At no point in your rambling, incoherent response were you even close to anything that could be considered a rational thought.
Thanks for listening to this episode of This Week in Geek. Hungry for more? Check out our website at thisweekingeek.net. You can subscribe to the podcast, browse our Twitter and Instagram, and leave your thoughts on today's topics. If you'd like to give us some feedback, send us an email at feedback@thisweekingeek.net. Tune in next time, and remember,
lower your shields and surrender your listenership.
We would be honored if you would join us.
Thank you for your cooperation. Good night.